I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Tony Hillerman's haunting tour of terror. The Blessing Way. Starring Ed Nelson. Barbara Anderson. And Tig Andrews. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
A Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by State Farm Insurance and the makers of Beechnut Chewing Tobacco. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Dr. Bergen McKee, anthropology professor, had been busy doing his homework. An old Navajo woman had told him stories about wolves and witches. Though as a scientist, he needed documentation. So he set out to prove his theory, that superstition arises from fear. In short, witchcraft is a scapegoat for those who cannot explain away their woes rationally. Dr. Bergen McKee went to an abandoned grazing grounds and came across five dead rams, their throats slashed. Coyotes, he conjectured. But how could a relatively small animal scale a six-foot fence? And where was his colleague, Dr. Kenfield? Why hadn't he returned to camp? And why was there a letter from him signed John, when his name was Jeremy? Dr. Bergen McKee has several questions for which there are no scientific answers. And he has a fear. Irrational, perhaps, but real nonetheless. He's beginning to get the feeling that something is wrong in Many Ruins Canyon. Something dreadfully wrong. The Blessing Way resumes following this word.
The wind owl had flown so close to my face that I needed all my powers of self-control not to cry out. Something out there had frightened that bird, and owls are not easily frightened. I studied the worn outcroppings of sandstone across the canyon, straining to hear. I felt like a young child afraid of the dark, the unknown. An irrational fear, I thought, but perhaps not. I could think of nothing that had happened to this point that made any sense. One dead man with sand in his lungs, five dead rams with their throats slashed, and a wrong name signed to a simple note. So why be logical now? I moved cautiously away from the tent, back into the darkness, climbing slowly over small boulders, carefully skirting larger ones, until I reached the pocket of water-cut rock directly under the oak of a hanging cliff. The light of the climbing moon had moved halfway across the canyon floor. Nothing stirred. What I scanned was a quarry of immense, motionless, brooding quiet. Then I caught a motion. I stared until my eyes were burning. A sinister shape, half hidden by juniper. A boulder? No. A head. A dog's head. And it was moving again, inching slowly out of the shadows into the moonlight. First a muzzle, then the head, its ears upright, the mouth hanging unnaturally open. I rubbed my eyes to be sure. It was definitely a dog's head, though unusually high, unless he were perched atop a ledge. Suddenly there was motion again, and the dog became a man, a large man with a wolf skin over his shoulders, the empty skull atop his own head. He dipped into the moonlight for a split second and then disappeared in the shadows. Was it a man, or was it really a wolf? No, It was most assuredly a man running swiftly toward the campsite. He held something in his right hand, something metal that reflected the moonlight. A long barrel, then an ammunition clip, a machine gun. It was a man in wolf's clothing, stalking what he assumed to be a slumbering sheep. He was stalking me. What's he doing now? He was in plain sight, no longer making any effort at concealment, fooling with my truck. I was suddenly struck by the wild hope that he would just jump in and drive off, nothing more than a common thief. But no, he was going nowhere, nor was I. It was obvious the man had in some way disabled the truck. My only means of escape now was my own 2 feet. I touched the sandstone walls of the pocket I had chosen as shelter. They were smooth and steep. If I could only wiggle my way up through the crevice. But how could I manage that without making a noise? The man, or wolf, whatever he was, had gone into the tent. I could see a flashlight beam through the canvas. He'll see my notes. He'll know who I am, if he doesn't know already. Should I make a run for it now? Just take off across the canyon floor and hope to dodge a hail of machine gun bullets? Silly thought. There wasn't time to act. He was outside the tent again. No more than 50 yards away and facing this direction, looking at precisely the spot in which I stood.
Dr. McKee? Mervyn McKee? I need to talk to you about Dr. Canfield. John's hurt. He needs help.
The man's words repeated themselves, ricocheting off the canyon walls, driving home all of my worst fears. He referred to Dr. Canfield as John. He called me by name so he knew who I was. But who was he? All I knew was the man standing there in the darkness, this man in the wolf skin brandishing a machine gun, this man who had stalked me like an animal had come for one reason and one reason only, to kill me. Suddenly, the man ran across the canyon bottom, the wolfskin dangling from one hand. But I knew I was far from being out of danger. The man would surely climb to higher ground in order to improve his vantage point. From up high, he'd be able to see the entire canyon and me. Now was my chance. While he was moving, so could I. I worked my way steadily down the canyon, keeping close to the sheer sandstone wall. Finally, I reached the bottom where dense brush grew in massive clumps from the muddy soil. I found a small opening underneath one bush and squeezed in silently. Then for the first time in hours, I shut my eyes. I hadn't heard a thing for who knows how long. I had lost touch with time. All I knew was it was dark and the stars were out. Was the man gone? I had waited for what seemed like a full hour, and then moved. I crouched in the shadows, listening. He really was gone. But how far? And why? Then it came to me. If that lunatic had gone to all this trouble to learn who was living in the tent, he would also know of Ellen Leon. The letter announcing her impending arrival was on the table. The wolf, oh, the wolf. He would only have to wait for her. Well, I'd have to do the same. I decided the hell was self-preservation in the sedentary academic life. If I was going to get killed, I might as well do it with style. I no longer had the faintest hope that the morning would bring Jeremy Canfield driving up the canyon, but it would bring Ellen Leon. I took one deep breath, let it out slowly, then sprinted across the sand to the south wall. I had to get as far and as high as I could and find a place where I could watch the floor of the canyon. I'd wait there to intercept the car and Ellen Leon. I was making good progress, having scaled a third of the way up the south wall. There was a large boulder up ahead, surrounded by enough sandstone to afford me a blind. It would be a perfect viewpoint. Only it was so dark, I could barely see my way. It must have been nearly dawn, the darkest time of the day or night. The moon was down, and now the only light of all was from the distant stars. Now, I was only 5 feet away. But there was a gap, 5 feet of space I'd have to get across. It couldn't have been more than a 10-foot drop. I could see the stars reflecting a puddle of collected rainwater on the rocks below. I reached out and felt the rough bark of a tree limb. I held on to it with both hands and... I had fallen flush on my face, but had gotten one hand down to break my fall. I scrambled to my feet. I was out in the open. Suddenly there was a roaring in my ears and a screaming pain in my hand. The lights went out. When I regained consciousness, the sounds inside my head were gone, but not the searing pain in my right hand. I looked at it and saw that the little finger was bent grotesquely backward, a complete dislocation. Then I realized what had happened and where I was and what was at stake. The dawn had arrived. Ellen Leon would soon appear, and that madman was up there somewhere. I tried to pull my finger back into place, but the pain was too much. I rolled over and looked at my reflection in the pool of trapped rainwater. I looked a sight. The skin had been scraped from the right side of my cheek when I fell. In 2 days' growth of beard had sprouted, and my hair was caked with mud. With my left hand, I tried to wash the dirt and dried blood from my face. I was moderately successful, but nevertheless, Ellen Leon would be confronted by a grubby man with a torn and dirty shirt, hardly an appearance to inspire confidence. Oh, and that finger. I'd have to hide it from her, because what I had to say to her, improbable as it would seem, was the truth. There was an insane man dressed like a werewolf somewhere in the canyon, and he meant to kill us both. Then I heard it. A car was coming. From the echoes, I knew it was already in the canyon. Maybe it wasn't Helen Leon at all. Maybe it was Jeremy. And the whole thing was all just a bad joke. Maybe it was the wolf coming back to finish me off. Then I saw it rounding the bend, a Volkswagen. And behind the wheel, I could see the driver was wearing a hurried expression. It was Helen Leon. As soon as I saw it was Ellen Leon, I dashed out onto the road.
Miss Leon! Miss Leon! Miss Leon, stop! Miss Leon, unlock the door. I'm Burton McKee. I was supposed to meet you here, Dr. Canfield and I. You have to let me in. Turn the car around. Head it out of here.
What's wrong? Where's Dr. Canfield?
Look, I'm not sure exactly what's wrong, but I want you to get out of this canyon until I find out. There's a man somewhere up this canyon who isn't acting rationally. I think he may have done something to Dr. Canfield, and I don't know where the hell Canfield is, and I can't start looking for him until I get you out of here.
Oh.
Canfield was gone when I got back to camp yesterday. He left me a note, and he signed it John. His name is Jeremy.
Well, what did the note say?
Oh, something about taking a Navajo to Jignos Pass, something about a snake bite. Look, that's not the point, Miss Leon. He signed it, John. Listen. Now, you wait here. Come back! Miss Leon?
Sounds like a motor. What is it, a truck?
Look, I'm going to find out. All right, we'll both find out.
This woman, Helen Leon, had a certain Girl Scout quality about her. Delicate and yet determined. I was sure she doubted my story, but I'd expected that. Somehow, I'd have to stress the urgency of the situation without giving her further cause for alarm. It was less than 50 yards to the bend of the canyon. My hand throbbed violently every step of the way. When we reached the bend, I cautioned her to stay back. I peeked around the rocky point. There was a gray Land Rover parked a ways down the canyon. A cable from the winch reel on its front bumper was attached to a fallen ponderosa pine. The massive trunk of the long dead tree was being swung slowly across the canyon.
What is it, Dr. McKee?
It looks like we walk out.
What in the world is he doing?
He's blocking us in with that tree.
Is that the man you saw last night? The man with the wolf skin?
Yes. With all the racket the winch motor was making, the man couldn't hear us walk back to Ellen's car, started up and back off. At least she hadn't asked me how I knew that this was the same man. I don't know what lie I'd have made up. I couldn't have told her that I'd seen a long machine gun barrel sticking out of the Land Rover window, nor could I divulge the fact that I now had a pretty fair idea who the man was. The terrifying truth was, I'd met him before, face to face. It was the hat that gave him away. The man operating the winch was wearing one. A black felt hat with a wide brim, with a silver concho band around the crown. It was the big Navajo from Shoemaker's.
Is your hand broken?
No, I sprained my finger.
But it hurts a lot.
It's all right.
It would feel better if you'd let me bandage it. Don't you have a first aid kit at your campsite?
Look, I think it'd be better if we kept going. I want to find a place where we can climb out of here.
Maybe Dr. Canfield's back by now.
Maybe.
Can't we just...
All right. It's just up ahead. We'll need a few things anyway. Stop at the camp.
Thank you.
Don't mention it. Canfield wasn't there. I hadn't expected him to be, but she had. She sat glumly in the tent while I rounded up supplies. Harley, I filled my canteen, shoved two cans of meat into my pocket, grabbed a box of crackers in my pocket knife. Then I trotted over to where my truck was and raised the hood. I could feel her watching me from behind, but I didn't turn around. Instead, I examined the engine. The spark plug wires were ripped out.
Dr. McKee, really, shouldn't we have waited back there just for a little while? I'm sure Dr. Canfield will be coming right back. And if he doesn't, I'm sure this man will help us. This is absolutely insane. I'm turning the car around. What are you doing? Take your foot off of mine. You'll get us killed.
Now, get this straight. I had a hard day yesterday. I was up all night. I'm tired. My hands hurt. And I'm worried about Jeremy. Now, you're going to behave and do as you're told. And I'm telling you again, we're going to climb out of this canyon. Look, if I'm wrong about that guy, I'll apologize. I can't take that chance now. Please, you have to trust me, Miss Leon. Better slow down. The road's getting too narrow. Bully. Wait, I saw something.
What is it?
Tire tracks, you see? Along the bank there. Somebody's been here.
Dr. Canfield?
I need to find out. Put the car over there. Now get it past the brush. Out of sight.
Then what?
Wait in the car. And I'll be back for you. The tire tracks told me a lot. They were obliterated along the road, but visible on the bank. That meant whoever made them had done so before last night's rain. There was only one set, and from the angle of the flattened brush, I assumed that whatever went in, it hadn't come out. At least not this way. The road stopped completely, but the deep tread marks went on. Over rocks, through the brush, and until I could see where they were heading. There was a brush-covered outcropping of rock 50 feet away. Quietly, I approached. My heart was racing. It could be a trap set by the big Navajo. Slowly, very slowly, I peeked around. And so, a truck. Jeremy Canfield's camper. It was locked up tight, and the muddy streaks on the windshield suggested it hadn't been moved for a while. I looked in through a side window. No keys in the ignition. No Jeremy either. I wheeled around and saw up on the rim rock a flash of red. I stood frozen, looking at an Indian boy wearing a bright red baseball cap sitting atop a chestnut-colored horse. The boy had a rifle in one hand. It was pointed up at the sky. We stared at each other. Neither of us moved a muscle. And then he rode off. It was like a hallucination. He quite literally disappeared. The camper compartment was locked. I found a rock and broke out the glass, reached through with my good hand, and undid the latch. The tailgate dropped open, and out slid a pair of familiar boots. Jeremy Canfield's. He was still in them. I reached in and rolled him over. The great roaring in my ears returned as I stumbled back. I had seen the face of Jeremy Canfield, the bulging eyes ablaze with terror, the mouth wide open, shouting out a silent scream, and rimmed with sand.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Blessing Way. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Sometimes a challenge is a good thing. It helps to break up the monotony when one has been doing the same thing over a long period of time. Dr. Bergen McKee is a university professor with tenure, Anthro Department, and for the past several years satisfied with life behind ivy walls, inside an ivory tower, correcting term papers and smarting from the after effects of his shattered marriage. Dr. Bergen McKee needed a challenge, and this is precisely what he got. He's faced with the problem of climbing out of a deep canyon, over rugged terrain. The little finger on his right hand has been dislocated. He's been up all night, and he's accompanied by a young woman who accepts nothing he says as truth. But then his story is hard to believe. There's a madman dressed like a werewolf running loose in the canyon. He's burying people alive. And Dr. Bergen McKee must rise to meet the challenge or tumble into infinite darkness. For if he fails, he and the lady will most certainly die. The Blessing Way will continue.
Canfield was dead. Killed, no doubt, in the same fashion as Lewis Horseman had been. I raced back to where I'd left Ellen Leon. She was sitting on a rock, holding her ankle.
Oh, I'm so clumsy.
I told you to wait in the car. What happened?
Well, you were gone a long time. I was going to look for you, and I fell. I twisted my ankle. It hurts.
Yeah, can you walk on it?
I don't think so. You may have to go on without me.
No. Look, I mean, I can't leave you here.
Dr. McKee, I know you're just trying to protect me. I can appreciate that.
Let me see that ankle. It doesn't look bad. No swelling.
We really ought to take the car back to the camp and wait for Dr. Canfield.
We're not going back. I found Canfield's truck. Somebody broke in the back window. He's gone. Now, we've got to climb out now.
Please, you're hurting my arm.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to.
Please, Dr. McKee, you've got a concussion. You just can't go stumbling around like this.
You don't understand. Hey, Miss Leon, come back! I was too surprised to move for a moment. There was nothing wrong with her ankle. She had run off to the car, rolled up the windows, and locked herself in. I tried to keep my voice at a normal level. Really, Miss Leon, I'm not crazy. And we really do have to get out of here. Roll down the window.
Not until you give me your word you'll come back to the camp with me.
Don't make me use this rock. Now roll down the window.
No!
I promise. Let me in and we'll go back. No, I mean it, Miss Leon. Now you get out of this car or I'll drag you out. Get out!
That's right. Get out.
I knew without turning around who it was. He came around the side so I could see him, and he could see me.
Hold perfectly still.
He was a tall man, taller than I'd remembered him from Shoemaker's, but the same man. The sun was reflecting off of his silver hatband. In his hand was a gunmetal blue machine pistol.
You're Bergen McKee, and the young lady would be Ellen Leon.
What do you want?
Just the pleasure of your company for a while. Right now, I want your boyfriend to take his hand out of his shirt. Very, very slowly. That's it. Well, I say I've been too suspicious. That's quite a finger. Bergen, I'll have to ask you to put your hands against that pinion tree while I see what you have in those pockets. Ellen, you stand over there. Get some keys, your wallet. What, meat? Are you planning on getting away? Look, you hold that position while I check Ellen. Look, I want no movement at all. Do I make myself clear?
Yes.
Ellen, you hold your arms out to the side. That's a good girl.
Why are you doing this?
Ellen, I'm not talking to you, so don't talk to me. If you insist, I'll have to shoot you. All right, the two of you now walk ahead of me and do as you're told, and no one will get hurt. See, I carry this gun cocked with the safety off, and I'm very good with it. Now, let's go.
He had us hike across a canyon a ways, and then up over dense brush and tumbled boulders. It was a difficult climb. Then as I grew more tired, my hand hurt worse. Ellen, Girl Scout that she was, made it without need of assistance. I'd like to have seen my former wife do the same. The truth of one of the last things I heard Jeremy Canfield say echoed in my mind. Not all women were like Sarah. Certainly, Ellen Leon wasn't. There was a bitter irony to the whole thing. Ellen had come here in search of a missing man. I considered the possibility that he, too, was now permanently missing, with lungs full of sand, and the thought of the same terrible end for her was too much to bear. When we reached the summit, we paused to rest. I had to say something.
I'll walk right over there to the truck.
Why not let the woman go? She's of no use to you.
Why, Bergen, how considerate of you. But I'm afraid Ellen must go with us. You see, she's seen me.
She won't tell.
That's funny, Bergen, funny. Really, it is. I can think of two people who said that very same thing. I get in the truck. No, wait. Let me see that hand first. Are you right-handed?
Yes.
I was afraid you would be. That finger looks bad. We may have to soak it to get the swelling down.
I'm touched by your sympathy.
No, it's not really that. It's just that you're going to have to write a letter for us.
What if he refuses?
Well, then I'll have to kill you. Both of you.
No comfortable way to ride in the back seat of a moving vehicle, lying face down with one's wrist tied together and rope to one's ankles. Nor could I draw much comfort from the conversation coming from the front seat.
So this Dr. Green at Albuquerque knew you were coming to this canyon. Who else knew, Ellen? Hey, what about your husband?
I don't have a husband.
On a pretty girl like you, I find that surprising.
Life's just full of surprises, isn't it?
That's right, Ellen, that's right. You know what else surprised me? That Bergen sat around in the canyon and let me cut him off. Why did he do that?
Why don't you ask him?
I'm asking you.
Because I was a fool.
Didn't you believe there was a Navajo wolf?
He had that terrible bruise on his forehead. I thought...
Well, I would have got him anyway.
No. If it hadn't been for me, Dr. McKee would have gotten away.
Well, you don't know about us Navajo wolves. We turn ourselves into coyotes, dogs, bears, foxes, owls. We fly through the air when we need to.
He outsmarted you last night. You said so yourself. And he outsmarted you again today.
You're obfuscating. You don't know who I am, and nobody gets away.
From the big Navajo's questions, it became painfully obvious why Ellen and I were still alive, and why he wanted me to write that letter. One depended upon the other. For some reason, he didn't want anyone to come looking for us and find something else. Perhaps Lewis Horseman had accidentally found something. Jeremy Canfield could have, too. I was bobbing in and out of consciousness. I think we stopped once or twice, and then we were stopped. I was sure. There was another voice I hadn't heard before.
I see you got a woman, George. Where's the man you were after?
He's in the back. Get any calls while I was gone?
No calls. They better let us know soon.
Oh, they'll let us know. They'll let us know. Won't be too long now. You see anything?
Just that kid on the horse again, up on the top. Way off across the mesa. I couldn't hit him from here.
Get out of the car, Ellen. Come on, will you? I'm in a hurry.
I could feel the big Navajo untying the ropes that bound me. The other man had called him George. So now I knew his name, but I still had no idea what he wanted. When I stood up, I saw we were in a narrow side canyon. A few hundred yards above us was a series of ancient cliff dwellings built high on the canyon wall. But then the world started spinning again. I started to fall, but someone caught me and propped me up against the side of the Land Rover.
Yeah, Bergen's going to write that letter for us, Eddie.
He hasn't written it yet?
Oh, he will. You see, he hurt his hand. Come on, show Eddie your hand, Bergen. Huh? I said show him. There, you see? Why take a chance?
Too much money involved to take chances.
Don't talk so much, Eddie. You know, we're going to leave these two behind. The less they hear, the better.
Oh?
Eddie was a pleasant-looking, tall, wiry young man. Blonde hair and blue eyes, the Huck Finn physical type. But he wore a shoulder holster, housing a .38 caliber pistol. Another crazy man, I thought. But not cold and calculating like George.
You were asleep when we cleaned out your camp, Bergen. I hope you don't mind.
Yeah, would it matter?
Oh, we've no reason to kill you or Ellen. Now, you may doubt that, but it's true.
What have you done to Dr. Canfield?
Ellen.
What happened to Dr. Canfield was really a shame. You see, he seemed like such a nice fellow. Full of jokes, but don't you see? Dr. Canfield made one very bad mistake. He signed his letter John.
But that's his name.
No, Bergen, that wasn't his name. If it had been, I'd have caught you yesterday. And Ellen would be free as a bird.
You killed Dr. Canfield?
Yes, I'm afraid I did, Ellen. I'm sorry about that, but it couldn't be helped. Now, if Bergen here cooperates and writes what I say, we can leave the two of you up in one of those cliff dwellings with food and water. And maybe you can figure out a way to get down after we're gone. You see, it's your only chance, and I suggest you take it.
Yeah, what do you want me to write?
Well, you'll have to say you're leaving here, all three of you.
All three of us?
That's right. You, Ellen, and Dr. Canfield.
The big Navajo handed me a ballpoint pen. Then I delivered quite an authentic performance of suffering. The pain shot clear up my arm. My hand shook, and real beads of sweat popped onto my forehead as I managed a very sloppy... Dear Dr. Green. Well, that's fairly close.
Not close enough.
I could write it left-handed and say I hurt my right one.
Now, why would you write Dr. Green a left-handed letter with Dr. Canfield around? Well, Eddie?
Whatever you think. I don't know the odds.
Yeah. Let me see that hand again.
Why not shoot us now and get it over with?
Don't challenge me. I'm liable to take you up on it.
Look, maybe if I soaked it, I...
Eddie, take him up to the cliff place. The girl, too.
You think we got time
Just
for that?
Just do as I say. Now move.
Eddie led us at gunpoint up the slope to the cliff dwellings. They looked like Anasazi ruins. This was probably where Canfield had come. There was plenty of loose sand around. I noticed, too, hidden behind a screen of bushes, several camping articles, including a two-burner kerosene stove and two bedrolls. Whoever they were waiting to get a call from had to be camped elsewhere. But in the deep shade of late afternoon, I hadn't seen the aluminum ladder. Eddie assembled the four sections while the big Navajo kept his machine pistol pointed at us.
You got it, Eddie?
All set.
Now, Ellen, Bergen, after you.
We climbed up the ladder to the top of the cliff dwelling, then down a smaller ladder through a hole in the roof into a dark, dusty, windowless room. Once inside, Ellen and I sat on the floor. Someone took the ladder away. We were trapped, suspended in air. I could see Eddie's chin above us through the hole.
What's he doing?
I don't know. It's the other one I'm worried about.
Are you frightened?
Yes.
So am I. You aren't really going to write that letter, are you?
Not if I can help it.
Do you think there's a chance we can get away?
You picking up anything, George?
Hey, listen.
What's he say?
You hear something? A radio?
No. Do you?
I'm not sure.
What's that?
I think he's coming up.
What did he do to us?
Try not to think about it.
Bergen, I'm scared.
Gurley says tomorrow afternoon will do it.
Gurley's been wrong before.
Not this time. This is it.
I believe it when I see it.
Well, you'll believe it when you count your money. We fly tomorrow.
Ooh, hot damn.
What's that all about?
We'll know soon enough.
Well, now, how are we feeling? Quiet, I see. Bergen, I think we'd better try to get that knuckle of yours back in the joint. I'm going to be busy tomorrow, but by tomorrow night, I'll want that letter.
Okay, I think my hand's broken, not just dislocated.
I feel like that when they're pulled out. We can get it back in the socket.
No!
Ellen. Eddie, shine that light down here, will you? That's it. Now, Bergen, this may hurt.
Sadist.
All right, go ahead. I'm ready.
Go!
I had a dream. A dream I was buried alive. I could feel the sand gathering in my throat, sifting down through the windpipe into my lungs. And then I remembered where I was. My hand felt heavy, but the pain was nearly gone. I could feel it was tightly wrapped in some sort of a bandage. As my eyes adjusted to the dim light, I saw the horizontal figure of Ellen Leon against the wall. She was breathing deeply in sleep. Miss Leon, wake up. Miss Leon.
What?
Shh.
Dr. McKee, are you all right?
Yeah, I'm fine. Too fine, I'm afraid. My hand feels much better.
What time is it? How long was I asleep?
I don't know. Look, where did they go?
I heard them outside before, down below.
Both of them?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes. Where are you going?
Look, nowhere. I'm trying to think of a way we can get out of here.
The big one took the ladder when he left. I heard him say that he was going someplace.
When?
I don't know.
Did you hear the truck leave?
Yes. No. I mean, I'm not sure. I could have been dreaming.
Oh, think. This is very important.
Well, they said something about a girlie. Yes. Yes, I did hear the truck.
It's getting lighter. It must be morning. If the big one's gone, we've got a chance.
Dr. McKee, do you have any idea what this is all about? Who's girlie?
I don't know what's going on. Maybe they're crazy, the whole lot of them.
Why did they want you to write that letter?
He explained why.
Well, you know as well as I do that if they're planning to let us go, they wouldn't need a letter. Now stop treating me like a child. That's what Jim would do.
Jim?
Fiancé.
What?
The man I came out here to find in the first place.
The engineer, Mr. Hall?
Dr. Hall.
Sorry.
Don't be.
Well, I didn't realize you were engaged.
I don't think Jim did either. That's why I came. To tell him it was over.
Why? I'm sorry. It's none of my business.
I want to tell you.
All right, go ahead. I'm listening.
Well, he's tall. Rather slim. He's got blonde hair. In fact, he looks a little bit like Eddie.
No, he's not nuts.
He's nuts about one thing, though.
You.
I wish. No, it's money. Jim's very ambitious. Too ambitious, I think. He gets angry about it. He says he's caught in a system that gets you on a treadmill, and I'm quoting him. He says it takes $1 million to beat the system, pay your own ransom, buy back your own life.
Well, what's he doing out here? I mean, no gold or oil or anything like that.
I don't really know what he's doing out here.
Well, I hope you find him.
Thanks. What's that?
Come here. Look at this.
These? What is it? Hieroglyphics?
Oh, this is Hopi Kachina.
I forgot you're an anthropologist. Another doctor.
Yeah, but a dumb one. The Anasazis built these cliff dwellings, but the Hopis lived here since. And the Hopi always built an escape hatch at the bottom of one wall to keep from being penned in if they were attacked.
You think there's a way out?
Yeah, which side is the cliff on?
This one. Let me help you.
No. I mean, yes, Ellen.
Something fell out of your pocket.
Yeah, cigarettes. Hey, wait a minute. Somebody or something wants us to have a fighting chance.
What do you mean?
Yesterday, when we stopped back at camp...
Yes?
I threw a pocket knife into my shirt pocket. The Navajo must be both crazy and dumb. I still have it. Are you still scared?
Yes.
Well, it's good. We'll need that edge. There are 3, maybe 4 people in this canyon. Within the next hour, 2 of us are going to die.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Blessing Way. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Metropolitan Life Insurance Company, Quaker State Motor Oil, and Digel. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio. You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again...
rest your eyes and listen here.
To The Zero Hour. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.